कथा उपनिषद. द कथा उपनिषद इज एन एंशियंट हिंदू टेक्स्ट एंड वन ऑफ द मुख्य प्राइमरी उपनिषद्स एम्बेडेड इन द लास्ट एट शॉर्ट सेक्शंस ऑफ द कहा स्कूल ऑफ द कृष्णा यजुर्वेदा. इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज खाका उपनिषद एंड इज लिस्टेड एज नंबर 3 इन द मुक्तिका कैनॉन ऑफ 108 उपनिषद्स. The Katha Upanishad asserts that an individual who understands and reveres this town of eternal, non-changing spirit, is never crooked-minded and is always free. The Katha Upanishad consists of 2 adhyas, chapters, each divided into 3 valis, sections. The first adhyaya is considered to be of older origin than the second. The Upanishad has the legendary story of a little boy, Nachiketa, the son of sage Vajrasravasa, who meets Yam, the king of the dead. Their conversation evolves to a discussion of the nature of man, knowledge, Atman, self, and moksha, liberation. The word Upanishad is usually interpreted as sitting down beside. This Sanskrit word can be broken down into 3 parts and translated as upa, meaning near, ni, as down, and shad, as to sit. Thus the meaning of the word confers the intent of these texts to directly transfer knowledge and truth from teacher to student. The collection of Sanskrit texts known as the Upanishads are thought to be the direct teachings received at the foot of the ancient Indian sages or rishis. The chronology of Katha Upanishad is unclear and contested, but it is generally considered to belong to the later Upanishads, dated to the 5th to 1st centuries BCE. The Katha Upanishad is an important ancient Sanskrit corpus of the Vedanta subschools and an influential Shruti to the diverse schools of Hinduism. It asserts that Atman, self, exists, teaches the precept, seek self-knowledge, which is highest bliss, and expounds on this premise like the other primary Upanishads of Hinduism. Katha Upanishad was translated into Persian in the 17th century, copies of which were then translated into Latin and distributed in Europe. Katha Upanishad uses words that symbolically embed and creatively have multiple meanings. Like Taittiriya Upanishad of Yajurveda, each section of the Katha Upanishad is called a Vallis, means sections, which literally means a medicinal vine-like climbing plant that grows independently yet is attached to a main tree. This symbolic terminology is APT and likely reflects the root and nature of the Upanishads in Black Yajurveda, which too is largely independent of the liturgical Yajurveda and is attached to the main text. The chronology of Katha Upanishad is unclear and contested by scholars. All opinions rest on scanty evidence and analysis of archaism, style and repetitions across texts, driven by assumptions about likely evolution of ideas and on presumptions about which philosophy might have influenced which other Indian philosophies. The Katha Upanishad has 2 adhyas, means chapters, each with 3 sections, thus a total of 6 sections. The first section has 29 verses, the second section 25 verses, and the third section has 17. The second chapter opens with the fourth section of the Katha Upanishad, which has 15 verses, while the fifth section also has 15 verses. The final section has 17 verses. The first chapter with the first 3 sections is considered older because the third section ends with a structure in Sanskrit that is typically found at the closing of other Upanishads. Additionally, the central ideas are repeated and expanded upon in the last 3 sections, which makes up the second chapter. The Kathaka Upanishad is an important ancient Sanskrit corpus of the Vedanta subschools and an influential Shruti to the diverse schools of Hinduism. It asserts that soul, self, Atman, exists, teaches the precept, seek self-knowledge which is highest bliss, and expounds on this premise like the other primary Upanishads of Hinduism. The Upanishad presents ideas that contrast Hinduism with Buddhism's assertion that soul, self does not exist, and Buddhism's precept that one should seek emptiness which is highest bliss. The detailed teachings of Katha Upanishad have been variously interpreted as Dvaita, dualistic, and as Advaita, non-dualistic. Katha literally means distress. Katha is also the name of a sage credited as the founder of a branch of the Krishna Yajurveda, as well as the term for a female pupil or follower of Katha school of Yajurveda. The Katha Upanishad uses words that symbolically embed and creatively have multiple meanings. For example, a closely pronounced word Katha literally means story, legend, conversation, speech, tale. All of these related meanings are relevant to the Katha Upanishad. Nachiketa, the boy and a central character in the Katha Upanishad legend, similarly, has closely related words with roots and meanings relevant to the text. Paul Deussen suggests Nakiti and Na Aksyate, which are word plays of and pronounced similar to Nachiketa, means non-decay or what does not decay, a meaning that is relevant to second boon portion of the Nachiketa story. Similarly, Najiti is another word play and means that which cannot be vanquished, which is contextually relevant to the Nachiketa's third boon. Both Whitney and Deussen independently suggest yet another variation to Nachiketa, with etymological roots that is relevant to Katha Upanishad. The word Nasiketa also means, I do not know, or he does not know. Some of these Sanskrit word plays are incorporated within the Upanishad's text. The Upanishad opens with the story of Vajrasravasa, also called Aruni or Dalki Gautama, who gives away all his worldly possessions. However, his son Nachiketa sees the charitable sacrifice as a farce because all those worldly things have already been used to exhaustion and are of no value to the recipients. The cows given away, for example, were so old that they had drunk their last water, eaten their last grass, don't give milk, who are barren. Concerned, the son asks his father, "Dear father, to whom will you give me away?" He said it a second and then a third time. The father, seized by anger, replied, "To death, I give you away." Nachiketa, Katha Upanishad. Nachiketa does not die, but accepts his father's gifting him to death by visiting the abode of Yam, the deity of death in Indian mythology. Nachiketa arrives, but Yam is not in his abode. Nachiketa as guest goes hungry for 3 nights, states verse 9 of the first section of Katha Upanishad. Yam arrives and is apologetic for this dishonor to the guest, so he offers Nachiketa 3 wishes. Nachiketa, first wish is that Yam discharge him from the abode of death, back to his family, and that his father be calm, well-disposed, not resentful and same as he was before when he returns. Yam grants the first wish immediately, states verse of Katha Upanishad. For his second wish, Nachiketa prefaces his request with the statement that heaven is a place where there is no fear, no anxiety, no old age, no hunger, no thirst, no sorrow. He then asks Yam, in verse of Katha Upanishad, to be instructed as to the proper execution of fire ritual that enables a human being to secure heaven. Yam responds by detailing the fire ritual, including how the bricks should be arranged and how the fire represents the building of the world. Nachiketa remembers what Yam tells him, repeats the ritual, a feat which pleases Yam, and he declares that this fire ritual will thereafter be called the Nachiketa fires. Yam adds that along with 3 Nachiketa fires, anyone who respects 3 bonds with mother, father and teacher does 3 kinds of karma, rituals, studies and charity, and understands the knowledge therein, becomes free of sorrow. Nachiketa then asks for his 3rd wish, asking Yam in verse about the doubt that human beings have about what happens after a person dies. Does he continue to exist in another form or not? The remaining verse of first valli of Katha Upanishad is expression of reluctance by Yam in giving a straight yes or no answer. Yam states that even gods doubt and are uncertain about that question and urges Nachiketa to pick another wish. Nachiketa says that if gods doubt that, then he, Yam, as deity of death, ought to be the only one who knows the answer. Yama offers him all sorts of worldly wealth and pleasures instead. But Nachiketa says human life is short, asks Yama to keep the worldly wealth and pleasures to himself, declares that pompous wealth, lust and pleasures are fleeting and vain, then insists on knowing the nature of Atman, soul, and sticks to his question, what happens after death? Katha Upanishad asserts Atman, soul, self exists, though it is invisible and full of mystery. It is ancient and recognizable by yoga, meditation on one's self, states Katha Upanishad. This is one of the earliest mentions of yoga in ancient Sanskrit literature in the context of self-development and meditation. The Katha Upanishad asserts that the essence of Veda is to make man liberated and free, look past what has happened and what has not happened, free from the past and the future, refocus his attention past ignorance to knowledge, to the means of blissful existence beyond joy and sorrow. This is achievable through realization of Atman Brahman, asserts Katha Upanishad, and this essence is reminded in the Vedas through the word Om, Aum. That syllable, Aum, is in Brahman, means the highest, means the blissful within. In final verses of the second valli, the Katha Upanishad asserts that Atman knowledge or self-realization is not attained by instruction, not arguments nor reasoning from scriptures. It is comprehended by oneself through meditation and introspection. It is not attained by those who do not abstain from misconduct, not those who are restless nor composed, not those whose mind is not calm and tranquil, but only those who live ethically, are composed, tranquil, internally peaceful, search within and examine their own nature. The Katha Upanishad asserts that one who does not use his powers of reasoning, whose senses are unruly and mind unbridled, his life drifts in chaos and confusion, his existence entangled in samsara. Those who use their intelligence, have their senses calm and under reason, they live a life of bliss and liberation, which is the highest place of Vishnu. Whitney clarifies that Vishnu appears in Vedas as a form of sun, and Vishnu's highest place is a Vedic phrase that means zenith. Madhvacharya, the Dvaita Vedanta scholar, interprets this term differently and bases his theistic interpretation of Katha Upanishad by stating that the term refers to the deity Vishnu. The Katha Upanishad presents a hierarchy of reality from the perspective of a human being. It asserts that Artha, objects, means of life, are above Indriya, senses, that Manas, mind, is above Artha in this hierarchy. Above the Manas is Buddhi, intellect, his ability to reason. Above the Buddhi is Atman, his soul, great self. Beyond the Atman, states Katha Upanishad, is the Avyaktam, unmanifested reality, and Purusha, cosmic soul, is beyond the Avyaktam, and beyond the Purusha, there is nothing, for it is the goal, for it is the highest road. Katha Upanishad states that Prajna, conscious man, should heed to the ethical precept of self-examination and self-restraint, restraining his speech and mind by the application of his buddhi, power to reason. Man should, asserts Katha Upanishad, holistically unify his tempered senses and mind with his intellect, all these with his Atman, soul, great self, and unify his great self with the self of the rest, the tranquility of oneness with the Avyaktam and cosmic soul. Self, Atman, is soundless, touchless, formless, tasteless, scentless, without beginning, without end, imperishable, beyond great, blissful, and when one reveres one's own self, he is liberated. Such self-realization is not easy according to Katha Upanishad. Rise, awake. Having obtained these boons, understand them. Like the razor's sharp edge is difficult to traverse. The path to one's self is difficult. The fourth section starts by asserting that inner knowledge is that of unity, eternal calmness and spiritual oneness, while the external knowledge is that of plurality, perishable, running around, and sensory objects. The Katha Upanishad in 15 verses of the 4th Valli, as well as those of the 5th Valli, explains what is Atman, how it can be known, the nature of Atman, and why it ought to be known. Atman, asserts Katha Upanishad, is the subject of self-knowledge, the bearer of spiritual reality, that which is all-pervading, inside every being, that unifies all human beings as well as all creatures, the concealed, eternal, immortal, pure bliss. It exists and active when man is in awake state, it exists and active when man is in dream state. The empirical reality is the honey for the Atman, with the honey metaphor repeating, fruit of numerous karma flowers in the valley of life, doctrine found in other Upanishads, such as in the second chapter of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Katha Upanishad's fifth section is an eschatological treatise. It begins by stating that human body is like a pura town, city, with 11 gates that connect him to the universe. The individual, asserts Katha Upanishad, who understands and reveres this town of eternal, non-changing spirit, is never crooked-minded, is always free. The soul dwells in swan, in atmosphere, in man, in versad, wide spaces, in eternal law, everywhere in the universe. It is born of water, it is born of kind, it is born of the right, truth, ethics, morals, eternal law. It is born of stone, mountains, as the great the, as ought to be. This soul is worshipped by all the gods. Body dies, soul doesn't. The sixth Valli continues the discussion of karma and rebirth theory, sections of which Max Müller states is possibly interpolated and inserted in a later period. The first five verses of the last section of the Upanishad assert that those who do not know or do not understand Atman return to the world of creation, and those who do are free, liberated. Some unaware of Brahman's essence are naturally inclined to fear God and its manifestations such as nature, fire, lightning, sun, state Katha Upanishad. Those who are aware of Brahman's essence are awakened to the knowledge, fear no one and nothing, become immortal as with Brahman. The Katha Upanishad concludes its philosophical presentation in sixth section. The state of perfection, according to the last section of the Upanishad, explains Paul Deussen, consists not in the attainment of a future or yonder world, but it is already just now and here for one who is self-realized, who knows his self, soul, as Brahman, cosmic soul. This teaching is also presented in the other ancient scriptures of Hinduism, such as Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. The Irish poet William Butler Yeats dedicated several essays and sonnets to themes in Katha Upanishad and related ancient Upanishads of India. George William Russell similarly esteemed the Katha and other Upanishads. The American poet Ralph Waldo Emerson held Katha Upanishad highly, and wrote several poems and essays paralleling the themes in it. The various themes contained in Katha Upanishad have been subject of many scholarly works. For example, Elizabeth Schiltz has compared the parable of the chariot in Katha Upanishad and Platonic dialogue, Phaedrus, noting the remarkable similarities give rise to a great many tantalizing historical and literary questions, and adding the comment, each provides an image of the self as the chariot. They each offer a complex moral psychology and point toward an effective justification of the best life. Radhakrishnan notes that Katha Upanishad's discussion of good versus pleasant is evidence of ethical theories and philosophical longings of ancient human beings in India by 1st millennium BCE, much like those in Greek city-states in Europe. The Upanishad opens with the story of Vajrasrava, also called Aruni or Dalki Gautama, who gives away all of his worldly possessions. However, his son Nachiketa sees the charitable sacrifice as a farce because all those worldly things have already been used to exhaustion and are of no value to the recipients. The cows that were given away, for example, were so old that they had drunk their last water, eaten their last grass, don't give milk, who are barren. Concerned, the son asks his father, "Dear father, to whom will you give me away?" He said, "It is second, and then a third time. The father, seized by anger, replied, "To death, I give you away." Nachiketa, Katha Upanishad. Nachiketa does not die, but accepts his father's gifting him to death by visiting the abode of Yam, the deity of death in the Indian pantheon of deities. Nachiketa arrives, but Yam is not in his abode. Nachiketa as guest goes hungry for 3 nights, states verse 9 of the first section of Katha Upanishad. Yam arrives and is apologetic for this dishonor to the guest, so he offers Nachiketa 3 wishes. Nachiketa's first wish is that Yam discharge him from the abode of death, back to his family, and that his father be calm, well-disposed, not resentful and the same as he was before when he returns. Yam grants the first wish immediate, Katha Upanishad. For his second wish, Nachiketa prefaces his request with the statement that heaven is a place where there is no fear, no anxiety, no old age, no hunger, no thirst, no sorrow. He then asks Yam, Katha Upanishad, to be instructed as to the proper execution of fire ritual that enables a human being to secure heaven. Yam responds by detailing the fire ritual, including how the bricks should be arranged and how the fire represents the building of the world. Nachiketa remembers what Yam tells him, repeats the ritual, a feat which pleases Yam, and he declares that this fire ritual will thereafter be called the Nachiketa fires. Yam adds that along with 3 Nachiketa fires, anyone who respects 3 bonds with mother, father and teacher, does 3 kinds of karma, rituals, studies and charity, and understands the knowledge therein, becomes free of sorrow. In his third wish, Nachiketa then asks Yam about the doubt that human beings have about what happens after a person dies. Does he continue to exist in another form or not? The remaining verse of first valli of Katha Upanishad is expression of reluctance by Yam in giving a straight yes or no answer. Yam states that even the gods doubt and are uncertain about that question and urges Nachiketa to pick another wish. Nachiketa says that if gods doubt that, then he, Yam, as deity of death, ought to be the only one who knows the answer. Yam offers him all sorts of worldly wealth and pleasures instead, but Nachiketa says human life is short, asks Yam to keep the worldly wealth and pleasures to himself, declares that pompous wealth, lust and pleasures are fleeting and vain, then insists on knowing the nature of Atman, self, and sticks to his question, what happens after death? The Katha Upanishad asserts that one who does not use his powers of reasoning, whose senses are unruly and mind unbridled, his life drifts in chaos and confusion, his existence entangled in samsara. Those who use their intelligence, have their senses calm and under reason, they live a life of bliss and liberation, which is the highest place of Vishnu. Whitney clarifies that Vishnu appears in Vedas as a form of sun, and Vishnu's highest place is a Vedic phrase that means zenith. Madhvacharya, the Dvaita Vedanta scholar, interprets this term differently and bases his theistic interpretation of Katha Upanishad by stating that the term refers to the deity Vishnu. This metaphorical parable of chariot is found in multiple ancient Indian texts and is called the Ratha Kalpana. A similar simile is found in ancient Greek literature, such as the Parmenides, Xenophon's prologue of Prodicos, and in the Platonic dialogue Phaedrus. The Katha Upanishad presents a hierarchy of reality from the perspective of a human being. It asserts that artha, objects, means of life, are above indriya, senses, that manas, mind, is above artha in this hierarchy, and above manas is buddhi, intellect, his ability to discern. Above buddhi is Atman, his self, great self. The Katha Upanishad states that beyond Atman is the avyaktam, unmanifested reality, and the Purusha, cosmic self, is beyond the avyaktam. Beyond the Purusha, there is nothing, as it represents the ultimate goal and the highest path. At the basic level of life, the interaction occurs between artha and indriya, sensory organs, while at the highest level, man becomes aware of and holistically realizes the entire hierarchy. The self is hidden in all beings, asserts the Katha Upanishad. It does not show itself, but its awareness is felt by seers with agra sukshma, subtle, more self-evident conscious, keen thinkers. Katha Upanishad states that Prajna, conscious man, should heed to the ethical precept of self-examination and self-restraint, restraining his speech and mind by the application of his buddhi, power to reason. Man should, asserts Katha Upanishad, holistically unify his tempered senses and mind with his intellect, all these with his Atman, self, and unify his great self with the self of the rest, the tranquility of oneness with the Avyaktam and cosmic self. Self, Atman, is soundless, touchless, formless, tasteless, scentless, without beginning, without end, imperishable, beyond great, blissful, and when one reveres one's own self, he is liberated. Such self-realization is not easy according to Katha Upanishad. The fourth section starts by asserting that inner knowledge is that of unity, eternal calmness and spiritual oneness, while the external knowledge is that of plurality, perishable, running around and sensory objects. The Katha Upanishad in 15 verses of the fourth section, as well as those of the fifth section, explains what is Atman, how it can be known, the nature of Atman, and why it ought to be known. For definition, it deploys an epistemic combination of positive assertions as well as exposition by elimination, the latter repeated with. Atman, asserts Katha Upanishad, is the subject of self-knowledge, the bearer of spiritual reality, that which is all-pervading, inside every being, which unifies all human beings as well as all creatures, the concealed, eternal, immortal, pure bliss. It exists and active when man is in awake state, it exists and active when man is in dream state. The empirical reality is the honey for the Atman, with the honey metaphor repeating, fruit of numerous karma flowers in the valley of life, doctrine found in other Upanishads, such as in the second chapter of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. To know Atman, look inward and introspect. To know objects, look outward and examine, states Katha Upanishad. Everything that changes is not Atman, that which was, is, will be and never changes is Atman. Just like a baby is concealed inside a mother's womb when conceived, Atman is concealed inside every creature, Katha Upanishad. Self is the Lord of the past, the Lord of the now, and the Lord of the future. Self is eternal, never born, never dies, part of that which existed before the universe was formed from brooding heat. Sun rests in it, gods rest in it, all nature rests in it, it is everywhere, it is in everything. To understand the eternal nature of one's self is to feel calmness, inner peace, patience and freedom regardless of the circumstances one is in, affections or threats one faces, praises or insults one is subjected to. Anyone who runs after sensory impressions gets lost among them just like water flows randomly after rainfall on mountains, state Katha Upanishad, and those who know their self and act according to its dharma remain pure like pure water remains pure when poured into pure water. The Upanishads occupy a unique place in the development of Indian philosophical thought. They contain the highest authority on which the various systems of philosophy in India rest. So Vedanta philosophy is directly related to the Upanishads. Not only the Vedanta philosopher professes his faith in the ends and objects of the Veda, but the Sankhya, the Vaisheshika, the Nyaya and Yoga philosophers all pretend to find in the Upanishads some warranty for their tenets. The fifth valli of the Katha Upanishad is an eschatological treatise. It begins by stating that human body is like a pura, town, city, with 11 gates that connect it to the universe. The Katha Upanishad asserts that an individual who understands and reveres this town of eternal, non-changing spirit, is never crooked-minded and is always free. The self dwells in swan, in the atmosphere, in man, in wide spaces, Varsad, in eternal law, and everywhere in the universe. It is born of water, it is born of kind, it is born of the right, truth, ethics, morals, eternal law, and it is born of stone, mountains, as the great Tha, as it ought to be. This self is worshipped by all the gods. Body dies, self doesn't. The Katha Upanishad discusses what happens to the self after death, stating a variant of the premise of karma theory that underlies major Indian religions. The sixth section continues the discussion of karma and rebirth theory, sections of which Max Müller states is possibly interpolated and inserted in a later period. The first five verses of the last section of the Upanishad assert that those who do not know or do not understand Atman return to the world of creation, and those who do are free, liberated. Some unaware of Brahman's essence are naturally inclined to fear God and its manifestations such as nature, fire, lightning, sun, states Katha Upanishad. Those who are aware of Brahman's essence are awakened to the knowledge, fear no one and nothing, become immortal as with Brahman. The Katha Upanishad concludes its philosophical presentation in verses 14 to 15 of the sixth section. The state of perfection, according to the last section of the Upanishad, explains Paul Deussen, consists not in the attainment of a future or yonder world, but it is already just now and here for one who is self-realized, who knows his self as Brahman, cosmic self. This teaching is also presented in the other ancient scriptures of Hinduism, such as Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. The various themes contained in Katha Upanishad have been subject of many scholarly works. For example, Elizabeth Schiltz has compared the parable of the chariot in Katha Upanishad and Platonic dialogue, Phaedrus, noting the remarkable similarities give rise to a great many tantalizing historical and literary questions, and adding the comment, each provides an image of the self as the chariot. They each offer a complex moral psychology and point toward an effective justification of the best life. Radhakrishnan notes that Katha Upanishad's discussion of good versus pleasant is evidence of ethical theories and philosophical longings of ancient human beings in India by 1st millennium BCE, much like those in Greek city-states in Europe. The book written by Swami Krishnananda, The Secret of Katha Upanishad. The contents of the present book form the theme of the discourses which the Swamiji delivered for 7 days during the Sadhana week held at the headquarters of the Divine Life Society in the year 1973, before an audience of seekers of varied endowments and differing capacities on the path of spiritual practice. Hence, the lectures bear, naturally, an informal and personal touch of the teaching style, and this also explains the conversational accent maintained throughout, rather than a stricter form of expression usually associated with a deliberately written text. The first discourse starts with the present state of human perception and understanding in its empirical setup, and explains the exoteric sacrifice, yajna, of sage Vajrasrava to gain celestial ends, the query of Nachiketas, at the meeting of Nachiketas and Yam, the lord of death, the three boons Nachiketas requested for, the temptations on the way, the persistence of the seeking soul, the distinction between the pleasant and the good in world experience. The second discourse explains the meaning of the pleasant and the ultimate good, the error involved in the desire for pleasant sensations of the body and the ego, the point concerning life here and hereafter, the pattern of world experience as analyzed, the spiritual import of the Upanishad teaching, the three stages of the mystic ascent of the soul outlined in the three boons offered to Nachiketas. The third discourse points out the disciplines that are necessary for the pursuit of the inner life, the need for a spiritual guide, the nature of the higher knowledge, the 7 4 stages of meditation on reality, the characteristics of the final goal of life. The fourth discourse delineates the superlogical nature of reality and its knowledge, the methods of yoga described through the analogy of the chariot of the human individuality in its relation to reality, as the most practical part of the whole exercise of spiritual endeavor, the difficulties on the path, the subtleties of the inner way of the spirit. The fifth discourse investigates the intellectual processes in sensation, perception and cognition, the techniques of abstraction, concentration and meditation, the nature and experience of the merger of the individual in the universal. The sixth discourse expounds the glorious march of the soul along the path to the absolute, the higher yoga of the consciousness and its supernal attainments. The seventh discourse clinches the mystery of life and death, and the methods of communion with the Supreme Being.